Hey everybody, it's Dr. Rex again. Sorry I don't have any time to do anything funny. Just wanted to get this video made quick, get it to you, help you guys out with some of these concepts. Last video, we talked about equilibrium. We saw the equilibrium constant, uppercase K, and what does that mean? How do we figure that up or set that up? It's products over reactants. What else can we divine from that value of K? Well, if K is much, much larger than one, that's gonna tell us that the number on top, the product, has to be a lot larger than the number on the bottom, the reactants. So we should have more product molecules at equilibrium than we do reactants. And in this case, we would say that equilibrium favors the production of products or favors products. What does it mean if K is very, very small or less than one? Well, now the number on the top has to be very small in relation to the number on the bottom. So we're gonna have a lot more reactant molecules than we do product molecules at equilibrium. So the position of equilibrium would favor the reactants. So a couple examples, nice little cartoon diagram. We have H2 gas here with white, mixing with Br2 gas here in tan or whatever color, and we get two HBr molecules. So here we are at equilibrium, and we can see way more, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 of those HBr molecules of the product molecules, and only one of each of the reactant molecules. So if we were to plug this in, we'd have 9 squared over 1 times 1, give us 81. So we'd have a K that's noticeably larger than 1, meaning products are favored, and that's exactly what that diagram or that illustration there is showing us. If we had a small equilibrium constant, N2 gas plus O2 gas makes 2 NOs, we go over here, we look at equilibrium, how many of those product molecules do we have? Only 2. We have 6 of the N2 reactant molecules and 4 of the O2, so same way, we could tell right away from the picture, more reactants than products, we could plug the values in. 2 squared is 4 over 6 times 4, which is 24. 4 over 24 is 0.16 or something like that. So we have a number that's noticeably smaller than 1. So again, reactants favored over products, which is what we're seeing in that picture. So consider the reaction A going to be. A are our little red spheres, B are the black spheres. Which one illustrates a equilibrium constant that is the largest value? So where we have the greatest number of B, the black spheres, over the smallest number of A, the red spheres. Then you can tell right away, right here, you have C. We have much more black spheres than red, and you could put the take the values, put one over the other. You could even see this will give you a larger K. The equilibrium constant for the reaction A to B is 10. So the reaction mixture initially contains 1.1 molar A and 0 molarities of B, which statement is true? At equilibrium, the reaction mixture should contain 1 molarity of A and 0.1 molarities of B, 0.1 molarities of A and 1 molarity of B, or it contains equal concentrations. Well, if we really wanted to, we could go ahead and even put those numbers in and see. We had a pretty basic reaction. We had A going to B, so our equilibrium expression should look like this with the concentration of B over the concentration of A, and we know that's equal to 10. So if we even tried some of those, they said in one case, what if we had 0.1 molarity of B and 1 molarity of A, what does that give us? 0.1. So that's not 10, that's much smaller. The other example was what if we had 1 molarity of B and 0.1 molarity of A, and that does give us 10. So that right there should be the concentrations we would see at equilibrium. And we know they're those concentrations because they get us that identical number for the equilibrium constant. So what does this mean in terms of the reaction equation? What if we manipulate this, or what if the reaction we have doesn't necessarily match the one that the book is asking us about or that we need to find out about? So much like Hess's law, if you remember, where we can kind of play with equations, we can flip the direction that they go, we can multiply them by certain coefficients, we can do the same thing here. And there's specific ways that's going to affect the K. So if we write the reaction backwards, we're talking about reversible reactions, so it can go forward or backwards, but usually with the convention, whatever we have on the left is our reactants, and whatever we have on the right is our products. So in this case, B products, C and D over reactants A and B. Well, we could write it in the reverse direction, where now C and D are the reactants and A and B are the products. And of course, so now we'd have A and B on the top and C and D on the bottom. Well, if you look at this algebraically and what's going on, the equilibrium constant in the reverse direction is 1 over the equilibrium constant in the forward direction, or essentially the inverse of that. So if we knew the equilibrium constant for the forward direction, let's say that was 10, but we wanted to know what's the equilibrium constant in the reverse direction, we could just do 1 over 10, and we could see there's our K for the reverse, 0.1. What if we need to multiply the whole thing through by a coefficient? The reaction that we need to get to doesn't match the one that we know or that we have. So you can see here we have two identical reactions in terms of reactants and products. It's an A plus a B going to C. And here reactants are A and B and products are C. But you'll notice, of course, on the right-hand side, the whole thing's been multiplied through by 2. So we have an additional coefficient of 2 in front of here. Well, what's that going to mean? It means when we take these raised to their coefficient powers, we're going to be doubling whatever that coefficient power is. So what does that mean? Well, algebraically, we can get that same value by taking K raised to whatever that power is. So if we multiply the whole reaction through by K, if we have the original K and we want to know the new K, we would just take that K squared. Or if we multiplied the whole thing through by 3, we would take our original K and we would cube it. We would raise it to the third power to get our new K. Lastly, what if we have a desired reaction that is a sum or combination of other multiple reactions that we do know? So we have A going to B and B going to C, but what we need or what we want to find the equilibrium constant for is A going to C. How do we do that? Well, we can take this equilibrium expression here, B over A, and for reaction 2 should be C over B. Well, we know if we want to multiply these through, and algebraically, what can we do to get C over A? Multiply them, the B's will cancel, and we'll have C as our product and A as our reactant, and there's our new equilibrium constant. How do we do that? Just like we did here, multiplying them. So if we knew the equilibrium constant for 1 and 2, and we wanted to get to the third one here, we could do the same thing, just multiply those individual equilibrium constants. K1 times K2 will give us our new, or K3, whatever you want to call it. So lots of different ways we can manipulate this, specific ways, and we could see specifically how is that going to affect the equilibrium constant. So now we have a reaction A proceeds to 2B or produces 2B, has an equilibrium constant of 0.010. What's the equilibrium constant for the reaction B going to 1/2A? So you'll notice not only have they flipped this reaction, they multiplied through the whole thing by 1/2. So we're going to have to take the inverse of the 0.01, so 1 divided by 0.01, gives us 100, and then because they multiplied it by 1/2, that's the same thing as doing the square root. So let's clear this quick. We had our normal K being this. Our new K is when we flip it, is that, which gives us 100, and they also raise K to this, or sorry, the 1/2 power, which is the exact same thing as the square root. So our new K in this case should be 10. And what do they get? 10. So because we can tell specifically what manipulations were done to the reaction, we know specifically what manipulations we need to do to K and how we can find the K for the new reaction. All right, so we're going to stop there. I'll make another short video covering gases and pressures related to the equilibrium constant. See you soon.